number 3, Aero Chord with Break Them, and SepticFlesh with Prometheus.
My number 3, which is a song that this artist Aero Chord, it's A-E-R-O and then Chord, C-H-O-R-D, that they kind of came out of nowhere. Mm-hmm. All of a sudden it was like dropping song after song that was really badass, and the song that kind of hit Christian and I the hardest, I think, by them was a song called Break Them. We'll take a listen to it and kind of see what your thoughts are. It kind of, sure. It's funny because it kind of reminds me of some of the lyrics of the first song we listened by him that he recommended, the horses, whatever.
A horse is a horse, of course, of course, and no one can talk to a horse, of course. That is, of course, unless the horse is the famous Mr. A.
What the fuck was the name
really
of the song?
Reminded you of it, didn't it?
Cry of the Blackbird?
Cry of the Blackbird, yes. No, I just can't remember.
Horses across the
horses
field.
Horses Winnie.
I just can't.
Horses Weenie.
Yeah.
What? Weenie the horse. Mm-hmm. So anyway, so we're going to do that now.
We do need the horse.
So we just popped over to the Boombox Music Talk YouTube channel and listened to Aero Chord and Anna Yvette sing Break Them, which I don't want to speak for you, Chris, but I know that when it first came out, this is one of the ones that hit us hard immediately. We were just like, whoa, that's just fucking cool.
It was just one of the ones that that type of drop and breakdown that it had that we really, really liked, and it had a really inventive way of using that saw, you know, sound effect, and it was just really, it was just fun, you know?
Yeah. And I felt like the thing that makes the breaks with its kind of like, because it's pretty just simple in scope and what it's doing, you know, and not a lot of movement, you know. Mm-hmm. It's just sounds kind of staying in the same sound scope, but if it's cool because the first has such a cool melody, like that, the melody is what gets me on it every time. Like I want to be heroic. Like it reminds me of Bonnie Tyler. I I need a hero.
Mm-hmm. That's like, exactly what I was
that
thinking.
That same kind of feeling, you know, funny. When I was yeah. a kid. Like, totally. That's kind of how I feel. I don't know, John, what are your thoughts on it?
Well, I didn't quite get the heroic sort of thing out of it, but I really liked the line. I mean, I liked the vocals yeah. in it big time.
Yeah.
I was immediately drawn to her, the tone of her voice.
Yeah.
And I was just like, I fell in love with her basically throughout that song.
Right.
I was just like, whoa, I gotta
hear
that.
More of that. Yeah.
So that was the big thing. I think the one thing that I have trouble with, and I think it's just because it's the intent on what you're listening a song for. Like the intent of just sitting and listening to this song, the structure kind of almost sometimes seems all over the place. Like you got mm-hmm. this beautiful sort of like vocal track. And then it kind of just stops and does this, you know, little dubstep kind of like interlude. And maybe it comes back to the vocal track and it does another interlude. Kind of.
Yeah.
So it, from that perspective, it doesn't feel as cohesive.
Right.
But when it's a background piece for me and I'm just kind of have it in the background, it works for that. In fact,
yeah.
I, not to get too lewd, but that would be a perfect song to like have sex to. Mm.
Yes.
Or yeah. just to make out, you know.
We have like a Pandora station for that.
Like I was instantly put there. I
mean, yeah.
It was just like.
Just feels that way.
Just see, you know, just you know, hang with somebody.
Well, okay, so what's funny about that is there's a perception sometimes of electronic music being kind of very contained. And a lot of this kind of stuff is written by people who are more like kind of DJ artists.
Right.
They're musical. They're, you know, they know music, but so what they're doing as they do it is they have all these samples and loops of things. So they're always layering and unlayering as they go.
Mm-hmm.
So they have sections that are the same, just like you do like in a rock song or whatever, like a verse, chorus, break, whatever. Mm-hmm. But within those things, sometimes things will change more than it would in a regular song because it just depends on what kind of feeling they're feeling to get there of what things that they add to layer in on each other.
So sometimes they might speed it up, they might slow it down, they might, you know, I don't know.
Yeah, it's weird because when you guys, hearing you guys talk about it, you're like on a different level than what I'm, you know, like
right.
you notice things. So you've obviously been around this type of music more.
Yeah.
And so you hear those things a lot better than I do, you know, so I'm not like they're maybe went below me or something or above me, whatever.
And there are a lot, it's very much like the metal kind of stuff that we're hearing too, is that you have to kind of listen to it a couple of times and then you start to get where they're going and then it makes sense. But if you just listen to it just off the fly, like, oh, this is, you know, the next song on the radio and you're like, what? You know, but once you sit with it for a little bit, you start to understand kind of what they're doing and then it becomes very cool,
right.
You know.
It is. It's like an instrumental story, like kind of, you know, probably much in the same way that yours is. It's like a, you know, you're building this picture, you know, with the different instruments.
My father and I came to be at odds, so I forged my own path. But he was still my father when you put a sword through his chest.
So that's why you're not gonna help me. That's why you won't tell me who this Prometheus is.
Number three, for you.
Yeah,
we're at that point already.
Yeah, in fact, I was looking down at my sheet here, and I thought, wow, I didn't realize that I'd picked two bands that were Greek metal bands. But this is also another metal band, extreme metal by this. In fact, it's kind of has a symphonic element to it. I don't know why I'm just flipping like, out here.
Yeah, they're good.
I really like them.
I like them because they're good.
Well,
and stuff.
There have
like them too with me, please.
It's one of those bands that when people ask me like what I'm listening to lately, I can never remember the name. And I look at it and I go, how can I forget that? It's SepticFlesh.
Oh, yes. You told me that the other day and I immediately vomited. And I came back and said, okay, tell me about this band.
So this is, it's one of their newer tunes from an album called Titan. And the song's called Prometheus.
Well, I do love the word Titan. I mean, I'm a, you know, I studied, you know, mythology pretty in-depthly at, ironically, it was for English, and I can't speak, so I flank out.
I'm trying to learn how to read, because I read better, because I hear it's, like, good for you or something. Anybody here? It's got a good reputation, right? Nobody ever bad-mouths it. You never see a point-counterpoint show about reading. And in the pro side of reading, like a professor with a bow tie. And in the opposite side, hey, let me tell you something. Reading don't never do nothing. Because if you did have it, the book, and you looks at it, then you might not even know why you had to do that. I have nothing to add.
Anyway, so Titan, Prometheus, those are, I mean, that's awesome. You're hitting some of my words, like,
okay, you're hitting your G-spot.
I've got
man.
Him right with a word now, he'll,
yeah.
But so, this is one of the very, very interesting tune, I think, by them. It really blends the symphonic with the extreme sort of metal. So,
okay, cool. Let's take a listen. So yeah, so we just hopped over to the YouTube channel there and listened to what was the name of the band?
SepticFlesh.
SepticFlesh.
It was called track called Prometheus.
Prometheus, yes, on their album Titan, which already I have such a soft spot for anything Prometheus. Just I mean, Prometheus Rising, Robert Anton Wilson, yep. Was just such a man pivotal.
Never believe fully in anybody else's BS. I don't care if it's Roger Neish, the Pope, L. Ron Hubbard, Al Gore, George Bush, or I don't care who it is. Don't swallow all their belief system totally. Don't accept all of their bullshit, all their BS. The second rule is like unto the first. Don't believe totally in your own BS, which means that, as Bucky Fuller said, the universe consists of non-simultaneously apprehended events. Non-simultaneously. The universe consists of non-simultaneously apprehended events, which means any belief system or reality tunnel you've got right now is going to have to be revised and updated as you continue to apprehend new events later in time, not simultaneously. This is the natural functioning of the human brain. It's the way children's brains perform before they're wrecked by the school system. It's the way the minds of all great scientists and artists work. But once you have a belief system, everything that comes in either gets ignored if it doesn't fit the belief system, or it gets distorted enough so that it can fit into the belief system. You got to be continually revising your map of the world.
If you guys listen, if you want to read a book that will probably change the course of your life, at least in just a little bit, in some ways, go out and check out Robert Anton Wilson's book, Prometheus Rising, that my brother John here actually introduced me to. I've been trying to get my wife to read that. She's got a stack of about 17,000 books.
I know that feeling.
And I've started all of them. Yeah. I just haven't finished any of them.
It'll take you like 10 years to finish all of if you start all of them. At once.
I know. Well,
one day we'll just finish the library all at once.
Yeah, it will happen.
I'm done.
Yep, we're done. Now we can die.
No, but yeah, I mean, you can know kind of about, you know, just what the thinker thinks, the prover proves. So anyway, so you had some feelings on this song right away. What was that?
So
aside from running to run away and scream.
No, it wasn't even that, actually. Surprisingly, well, first of all, the song very much feels Prometheus to me.
It does.
Like, it's very much an embodiment of what I would imagine Prometheus, you know. So,
like, if Prometheus came down right now, we'd be like, hold on, play this.
Let's play your song. Let's play the song of your people.
He's a god that becomes associated with humans because he's a champion for humans. Right? The mythological stories talk about how Prometheus is basically like their representative.
wait, go back, come back again. Let's say that again.
But yeah, no, I was expecting, just for this experience overall with this type of metal, I was expecting not to be hearing music that made sense, I guess I should say. But I've been pleasantly surprised. All three so far of the selections that you've shown us have been pretty fucking cool, I think.
Yeah.
I mean, really.
Well, I mean, like, she's a big fan of at least the first Evanescence album.
Yeah,
that,
so am I.
It doesn't really matter, but I mean that, yeah, and it has a lot of those symphonic kind of elements, and she gravitates towards a lot of that anyway, and I do too. I mean, anytime you can introduce any other sounds to me, it's just cool. But I loved the use of like the horns. That's something that's kind of different.
None
of
it does different. That.
I think that was those sliding trombones they were doing on that part. It just, man, it sounded really cool. Like you mentioned, I think.
But it gave it such a different depth than, you know, a lot of other songs maybe in that genre, or even just metal songs to begin with. You know what I'm saying? Like, it gave it a different depth.
Yeah, there tends to be, in a lot of what I listen to, some of the sort of extreme metal that's out there, I get bored by, but bands like this, they give me the heaviness I'm looking for, but they have, there's an intelligence there.
Yes.
Behind, you know, the composition and,
right,
and things like that. Once you were a
And you can tell that too by by what you're listening to. Like, you can tell, it's evident in their product. You know,
yeah,
it's not just an accident. You know.
However, it was funny that I thought two things while we were listening to that. One, there was some parts where they went in some different places with the strings than I would have necessarily went, you know, or whatever. But it reminded me of like me. I remember showing you Skid Row's second album, Slave to the Grind, and there's some slow songs on there, like Quicksand Jesus.
Yeah.
They're just fucking fantastic.
Oh yeah, that's a great album.
So I remember showing you the harmonies, and I was trying to like learn how to do those because they were so good, and you kind of were like, well, you know, they're not really doing some things right, and Because you were just caught up in your Guitar Institute days, and you don't remember that?
No, I don't.
Yeah, you were just
because I remember I really loved that album.
Yeah. No, you kind of there was a time period where you kind of put that down a little bit in terms of some where you went vocally with some stuff, and I was kind of seeing like what you're listening to now. I'm proud of you. Stepping out of that a little bit now and listening to things that don't necessarily always go together like they're supposed to.
Yeah, I think in his voice at that time, I mean, he didn't have a real refined voice.
Yeah.
It wasn't like a singer where, you know, every note was pitch perfect and that. And I was stuck in that musical element at that time, but I come to appreciate that stuff a lot more now because it was so rock and roll. You know, it's not perfect. It's just him, you know, his showing his emotion and just putting himself out there, and that's what was so cool about it. So
yeah. So that I'll definitely check out some more stuff by them too. Anything that's cinematic like that, we're usually down for checking out.
We love celebrating great classic albums and artists that left us forever changed. But we also love that dopamine trip we get from discovering new artists that instantly bring about goosebumps. With over 20,000 songs in our home library, it's an addictive habit we should probably think about curbing one day. But for now, here's Aviva. You keep calling me a sucker. Born in Australia as Aviva Anastasia Payne, with a name like that, gotta be destined for greatness, right? In the realm of artists like Billie Eilish and 21 Pilots, she debuted in 2017 with her viral smash hit, Girls. I could say I'll take you, I could say I'll make you, but underneath all between then and now, she has released hit after hit after hit with an original vibe, fresh production, and all the whimsy even Alice had in Wonderland. Don't blame it on her. Whether it's peanut butter on your brain like Psycho, syncopated melodies on Rabbit Hole, or hitting you right in the feels after that missing downbeat on the chorus of Blame It on the Kids. She brings it every time. So check her out, let us know what you think, and now back to the show.